The worst thing about doing a television studio, I've done a few lately, of course, you know, you can't really ask them to turn off. Sometimes you can say, can you turn that off? It's so distracting to see yourself while you're, you know.
They'll start singing happy birthday and what to pay.
That's the polite version.
Well, it's still, I think, the most expensive song. It's like every, if you watch like talk shows, if anybody starts singing happy birthday, they stop them immediately or cut it out.
Tell me about it. Incredibly expensive. You've seen Secrets and Lies. Mm-hmm. It cost us, I think it cost us, I think it was something like 20 grand or something for sterling. Mm. For secrets, for every time you have it in a movie, it costs a fortune.
Yeah,
and you can't. It's sort of non-negotiable. You can't really say, "Oh well, we'll have something else," because there isn't anything else. That's what it is. You know, it's terrible. And the point is, it's a sort of, it's one of those. The actual authoress, it's a woman, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Has been long since dead, but it's just in perpetuity in an estate. In Another Year, which you saw, there's a moment towards the end when the Leslie Manville character is with the brother, mm-hmm. and they're smoking, and he says he likes Elvis, and she goes, "I'm all shook up," and that cost us 10 grand for the Elvis estate. And we were standing by to not have it, mm-hmm. but you know, it seemed so evocative and, you know, critical, really, and said so much about the character. And we decided to find the money, you know, but we were strapped for bread, you know, and we had it in, you know.
So it would never actually occur to me to have this conversation with you, but what do you have feelings about copyright? And because that seems to be the new...
Well, of course, it's the trouble is, it's a two-way issue. Because if someone uses a clip of something of mine, and, you know, I expect... you know, to be on the receiving end. Mm-hmm. It's a complicated thing. So, you know, I mean, fair enough. But on the other hand, I mean, to have to fork out 10 grand to go, I'm all shook up, literally that,
yeah.
is exorbitant. But there it is. And you, the bottom line is you can't have it both ways, really.
Well, I guess an artist like Turner kind of has... I guess the original work is in perpetuity.
No. Well, this is interesting. I mean, we could not have made the film if we'd had to pay copyright on all the work. Mm. It's all owned by somebody. It's mostly, virtually all of images in the film are in public collections or foundations around the world. Mm-hmm. And with one exception, all of them let us waive their copyright fees. Now, Turner died in 1851, so in fact, you would imagine that he's out of copyright because apart from the fact that there was no copyright convention until 1911 anywhere, the Berne Convention. But even by that convention, it was 50 years, it's now 75 years after. Mm-hmm. But because it's all in collections, they own the image copyright. Mm. But they were everyone was incredibly generous because they all thought it was a good idea that I was making a film about Turner, really. And so, but if we hadn't have been able to do that, we wouldn't have made the film, basically.
Yeah, I think there was one of the Van Gogh films that they had to kind of avoid the actual images.
Well, I don't know, is that true? I certainly, the film where it definitely happened is that film about Francis Bacon, the English painter. Mm-hmm. The Bacon estate absolutely wouldn't let them use the images, and so no images in the film are anything like Bacon's, mm-hmm. which completely, as far as I can see, renders the entire operation more than pointless, really.
So was the process of rendering Turner for the film, for actual use in the film, terribly complicated, or are there people who just do this and are good at it?
There are three kinds of things in the film. One is, mostly, they are very good reproductions that the production design department had made, and they did them quite cheaply, photographic reproductions, from source, you know, from the galleries or whoever, which they then devised a very clever way of coating with thick varnish so they actually look like oil paintings. Where you see a half-done painting, or a painting that Timothy Spall is then continuing, we've got a very good guy who's very good at painting Turners, you know, a guy called Charlie. And
just Charlie.
Well, he's got a name. but the other thing is that in Petworth, in the country house where he goes, and you see Turners in the wall, in the carved room there, which he looks at with his host, those are the real Turners. Those are actually the ones that he actually painted. It was quite freaky doing that because we were actually there where he actually put them, you know. But that's the only time you see real Turners in the painting.
And you also kind of recreate them in terms of the cinematography.
Of course. I mean, you know, the whole film is informed by a sense of Turner and Dick Pope's brilliant cinematography. To achieve that, we looked at the work. We were able to look at the, I mean, the archive in London, which is the Turner Bequest. They opened their doors. What did I say?
Fans but, everywhere.
I know. They love it. They love the film. you'll have to now dub that on because they were very generous, the archive in London, and we were able to look at Turner's colour. It's terrible.
You mean
it
closed the door? I'm sorry. Yes. They're much more enthusiastic than we expected them to be.
Yes, the thing is, I, you know, and I put my trousers back on.
We love the second act.
Yeah. I mean, excuse me, I'm trying to be serious here. Awesome. Should we start again on something?
Should we go on Dick Pope's?
Yeah, are you running? Well, Dick Pope's great cinematography is informed by Turner, and we looked at the paintings, we looked at Turner's palette, his colours, his, just look at the atmosphere, really. Sometimes you get an actual image, which is effectively a Turner. Sometimes it's Turner-esque. But the whole spirit and flavour of Turner, I hope, informs the film from beginning to end, really.
So you've been doing this with Dick for 25 years.
1990, we made Life is Sweet, and he's shot everything I've done ever since.
So was there new technology involved with how he made this, and was that interesting for you to get into?
Yeah, we shot this on a Ariflex Alexa digital camera. We made a short for the Olympics in London, Olympic Games, called A Running Jump, a comedy, just before we made this film. So we tried that. He's actually shot digitally himself on other movies. For me, it's a first. It's very exciting. There's no getting around it. It's great technology, and it's a great set of tools. And we embraced it. You know, we are 20th century men. We're celluloid men. We've waved the flag for film. That's great. But, you know, the laboratories are closing down. It becomes more and more impossible to do all that. We approached the new technology not grumpily because we couldn't shoot on film, but because it's there, and we were positive about it, and it is brilliant. There's no getting around it. You know, just having gone through a long Luddite period about it, I'm terribly sorry. I'll quickly turn that off.
Occasional bing.
Having gone through a Luddite period, which we've now come out of, you know, you might as well say, well, you know, it's tragic that I sit in my flat listening to music on CDs and not on wax cylinders, really, you know, because we move on, basically.
So are you enjoying it at all? I mean, are you getting your hands into it?
What do you mean?
I mean, obviously, Dick did a lot of the work in terms of what the technology was doing in terms of the image, but did you get to like work through color grading with him and really kind of?
Yeah, I mean, he does it, but I mean, I'm there, you know, and you know, it's a matter of consultation. And also, I mean, there's one sequence in the film which is pretty well entirely CGI, which is where Turner sees the great ship, the Fighting Temeraire, being towed off to be broken up, a ship that was famously at the Battle of Trafalgar. Which is a one of Turner's, probably his most famous painting. We shot the empty seascape at sunset when we shot the guys in the boat looking at it. Mm. And the rest was a collaboration with these clever guys who do all that stuff, mostly on big movies. And it was magic. And, I mean, I was very skeptical. Not skeptical, but cautious. And I said, you know, this has got to work. If it's not believable, we won't have the scene. Mm-hmm. And I mean, I think it's a gas, don't you?
Oh, yeah. But I mean, it's funny because it's so against what I guess it feels like your method and style are in terms of the organic nature of your work. You know, what we see as an audience of your actors is so raw and organic that to have anything but it doesn't feel false.
No, I know. I mean, that was the thing. I mean, that's why I was cautious. But, you know, you absolutely buy into it. I mean, you know, if you buy the whole thing, I mean, you buy that, you know, because, you know, people say, well, is the film accurate? Do you take, is there artistic license? Do you take liberties? Well, you know, you can research for a million years. You can read every word that's ever been written about a historical. But, you know, you're only then dramatizing what is in your head. You're not actually dramatizing what. We weren't there. So it's an imaginary world anyway. And it's, in any case, inconsistent with the style of what I do, despite the fact that it is always apparently real and has that raw rawness about it, as you put it. It is always heightened and distilled. It's never naturalistic. Right. It's not quasi-documentary, you know. Yeah. So I think it, such an image and such an element actually fits in, beds in quite easily.
Is there somebody in the process, while you're, particularly as you're right before production and in production, who is on a picture like this, which is a biography, looking for details that may be changing because the characters or the actors are changing it, or the thing
we had a full-time researcher who is an art historian herself, who'd worked at the Tate Gallery and all of that, on the film, on the picture as part of the team for 2.5 years. You've got to have such a person to point you in the right direction, to check things out and do all that. In the end, it's a collaboration, as always, with my films, between myself and the actors and the designers and everybody else, to arrive at something that works for everybody, you know. And for me, that's how it works. That's what makes it possible for me to have the real control over it. People say, oh, well, you know, if people are improvising, how do you control? Actually, I probably have more control over things than many a director does, precisely because everybody's on the same page, and it is, all, as you say, organic. You know.
Well, by the time you're shooting, is everybody so kind of there that you don't go off the rails? I mean, is there any moment where people went, okay, well, now this is getting a little bit too...
No, because we prepare everything properly before we shoot. So, you know, you have rehearsals and build scenes and, you know, check things out and get it right and then film it, you know.
So Tim knows where he's going 2 months before. He really kind of, in terms of like the boundaries of the character, in terms of
Well, you're talking about the characterization, the way he plays the character. Yeah. Oh, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, as with all these films that I've made, you know, you make the character solid, the characterization is solid and consistent, and then you can take him anywhere, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not the kind of thing, because of the preparation and the foundations, it's not the kind of thing which I think you're talking about, where suddenly the performance lurks off in a completely tangential direction, and that's got nothing to do with what was shot 2 weeks ago.
Well, I'm just saying the romantic entanglements and things like that, that people maybe, you know, people who are into the history of Turner maybe obsessively trying to figure out what the relationship was and what day and what year and stuff.
That's a starting point, and it's a sort of very useful discipline. But in the end, I mean, it's not a documentary, it's a movie. And you have to, you know, we cram 26 years into 2.5 hours. So we do miss out quite a lot of details, and I've actually reorganized things, of course, you know. But that's the name of the game, really.
So I think I know the answer to this, but it's a movie about aging. It's a movie about an artist. It's a movie about somebody who is beloved by the universe, the people who are looking at his art, and who is revered in a way. Is this in any way a personal film for you?
It's personal, but I don't think you mean that. You mean, is it autobiographical?
Well, not completely, certainly not completely autobiographical, but is it thematically?
Well,
it,
yeah, I mean, look, I've made two films where I turn the camera around on us, what we do, topsy-turvy, and this film. So in the sense that it's looking at somebody being creative and struggling with the project in relation to life, sure, absolutely. But it's not any more specific than that, because really the job in making the movie is to look at that guy in his world and say, well, what's all that about, really? And the whole question as to how, what it means for us, or how we relate to it, kind of looks after itself, really, on the basis of what I fundamentally think, which is that everybody's interesting, and everything's meaningful in terms of the audience's understanding of life, really.
So there's the great old line, you know, getting older is not for sissies. And it's, Turner is facing that moment where things are evolving and things are, I mean, and you, it's interesting actually how many British directors, particularly of your era, are still working. And it's kind of remarkable, because American directors over 60 basically stop working.
I hope they're enjoying themselves by their by their pools.
I can't imagine you sitting by the pool and
No. Well, your lack of imagination is entirely justified. look, you know, I'm 71, in case you're interested. So, you know, of course, it is the case that certainly this film and my last film, Another Year, to some degree were concerned with, both films are concerned with, on one level, with the end of life, growing old. I mean, obviously at the center of Another Year was this woman who looks into the dark hole of, you know, not being gorgeous anymore and growing old, you know. So indeed, this film, you know, goes to the end of a guy's life and he dies. You know, you can go no further than that.
Unless you're Chris Nolan, then you could.
Well, so I mean, of course, that's of interest, and you know.
And do this group of directors who are of your age and of your kind of who've been working through all these years that you've been working, does it feel like you're part of a gang, a group? Is there a connection between you all in the UK?
I think there is a fraternity of film directors. I mean, of course, you get curmudgeons, and I'm not one of them, who like to persuade themselves that they are separate from everybody else and they are competitive. I mean, I can think of one distinguished British director who is so profoundly competitive, it's to a point of neurosis, and simply cannot tolerate the notion that anybody else has got any success of any kind. And really, I think wants all the other film directors to be run over by a train, really. But that is a particular kind of psychotic disease, which, you know, I think more or less I would say there is a fraternity amongst film. If I go to a film festival, or, you know, mostly that's the context, you know, directors gravitate to each other, because you don't get to meet directors in the job, you know. So I think there is that fraternity, yeah.
Do you get to see films? Have you seen other films this year? Or do you get?
There are filmmakers, of course, who say, I can't watch other films. It's distracting. It's inhibiting. I mean, I just think that's ridiculous, basically. I mean, you know, you would expect novelists to read novels and artists to look at paintings, etc. I love watching films. I mean. Yeah, I was say, for example, at the Toronto Film Festival a few weeks ago, and I had 2-3 days with a pass, just going in and out watching movies, you know. It's great. I love it.
Most people go to the film Toronto and go, they don't have time for all of that, and it's going
to... Well, I was lucky. I mean, that's happened to me, but I was lucky because of because I was elsewhere and there was time. Every year, the London Film Festival happens, which is like Toronto, a festival of festivals. It shows movies from all around the all the other festivals. And I get a free pass because I'm a filmmaker. And so I clear my diary and see as much as I can. This year, the diary filled up with doing all this stuff I've got to do for Mr. Turner, including going abroad and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I saw one film in the London Film Festival, and I'm thoroughly pissed off about it.
So do you, there's obviously there's kind of all these comic book movies and all the CG movies, and you've spoken to that in the past, but do you feel like there is a dearth of quality films being made or ambitious films being made in the world?
Well, did you say in the world? Is that what you just
said?
Well,
the whole, I think because independent film is now a worldwide
thing. Well, this is the point. I have to say, and I know I'm sitting right here in the city of Los Angeles, but the fact is there are two things in the on the planet. World cinema and Hollywood. Mm-hmm. And world cinema is very, very diverse and rich and quite often poor and low budget and plugged into the real world. People are doing all kinds of really interesting things, and that is what I feel part of. If your question is about Hollywood, then that's a whole different matter. And I think some very interesting things have always and continue to happen in Hollywood, particularly in the areas of experimenting with new technology to commercial ends. Mm-hmm. But there's such a diversity of stuff going on in the world, if you really look at the world properly, mm-hmm. In terms of filmmaking, both feature film and now documentary filmmaking, mm-hmm. that I think it leaves one feeling very positive about it, really.
Well, it's funny because, I guess it is your perspective and the to me, the universe, as it's now been 30 years since Spielberg really changed all of this and Lucas, that is like another part of the business that didn't really even exist in the old studio system. And they take up enormous amount of energy and money and everything else and a lot of attention. But the rest of the world is still happening. It's not like people stop making dramas. And
that's the point. That is the point. And obviously my agenda or message or whatever you want to call it is, and particularly conversations in this town, is, just have to remember that it's all going on out there where we are, which is in Europe, in Asia, in Australasia, in Africa, and not least in Africa,
And getting easier to access, which is the great thing,
Because of that is the great thing. I mean, the new technology, it's not just about multi-million mega buck movies. It's about the fact that there is this high quality, cheap equipment that people can get their hands on and get straight out there. Young filmmakers don't have to worry about laboratory costs, about getting hold of film stock, hiring expensive cameras. You get hold of the technology, get out there and make a movie, and it's great, basically.
Yeah. I remember just even a few years ago having conversations on some low budget movies about, they didn't have, the money wasn't all there, and so they couldn't get they couldn't see their dailies because the,
Absolutely.
Now the dailies are in your camera.
Absolutely, and people say, yes, but that means that it's just, it's downgraded the quality and it's dumbing down all that stuff. Well, that may be true, that may be a downside, but it's not a downside to worry about, because the upside is positive, is that very good, interesting and creative things can and do happen with this fantastic tool.
And if you can light, you can light.
Say again?
Just because the technology is cheaper doesn't mean that a good piece of lighting is not still a beautiful piece of lighting.
No, and witness Mr. Turner, I hope.
And bad lighting is still bad lighting.
Absolutely.
Not every technology.
And you can point the most expensive camera in the most expensive studio at the worst acting you've ever seen. Yeah. But,
So is doing a movie with Timothy Spall kind of like putting on an old glove at this point, or is everyone a new adventure,
everyone's a new adventure. Every film is a new investigation. But I like to work. I like to work with new people. I like to work to come back to people that I've got ongoing creative relationships with. And the good news is there's a bunch of guys that like to come and play with me,
So is there a thing about Spall that is, because somebody, I was talking about it this morning at breakfast with some people, and they were saying, this would not be your presumption of a leading man would be Tim Spall's face. And yet, he is mesmerizing and has been for, all these years.
Well, of course, one of the perverse pleasures for me of doing the kind of thing I do, is to subvert the conventions of expectations of leading men and women, you know. I don't always deviate from the notion. I mean, Sally Hawkins is pretty kind of gorgeous, whatever you do with her, really. But and the whole point of Happy-Go-Lucky was to take that explosive energy and to make it drive to make up a movie that exploited that. Mm-hmm. But the idea that you're going to make a film about as complicated and curmudgeonly a character as J.M.W. Turner, and then cast, you know, Leonardo DiCaprio or something, just because he's gorgeous, would be eccentric, to say the least. And the great thing is to say, you know, Tim, here's Tim Spall, who's done, I mean, he's played main parts for me before, but he is a sort of, in the old-fashioned Hollywood sense, a character man. But all the actors I work with are character people. They're character actors. They don't just play themselves. They're versatile. Mm-hmm. They don't mind being gross, you know, because people are, we as people, real people, are beautiful and gross, you know. And the great thing is to subvert all those expectations. Say, okay, here is this guy. Same as what we did with Vera Drake. I mean, Imelda Staunton, mm-hmm. which is fantastic. Incandescent personality and a wonderful actress with a massive sense of passion and humour and everything else, but she's nobody's idea of a conventional gorgeous movie star. But what she does in that film, completely dissipating any notions of what a heroine in a film should or shouldn't be or look like or anything, is fantastic, you know.
So is it with somebody like Timothy or Imelda, who's been in more movies and smaller roles since then with you, and others, who Leslie's on this film also, and so forth. I mean, is it, does it have to be a kind of person who is great to work with? Is it the performance that connects with you? I mean, you guys spend a lot of time together in the process of doing this.
It's got to be all those things. It's got to be great to work with. You go on a dangerous journey with these guys, you know. They've got to weigh in and take risks, you know. You've got to, because I work, as you know, with no script in the conventional sense, we finally arrive at something which is very precisely scripted. I mean, you've got to do the whole, there are no shortcuts, there's no tricks. You have to get down to it and do the research, you know, have the time to build up the character and explore the relationships and do all of that. And it takes a lot out of people, you know, so they've got to be committed. But then, you know, we are blessed in the UK with incredibly committed and talented and intelligent actors, you know.
It's not really a movie. I mean, it's fascinating because you talk to British actors and it's a very different experience than American actors usually, because there is this sense of, you know, everybody was a spirit carrier at some point, and everybody end up going back to being a spirit carrier at some point, and they're all just, everybody feels like they're, even the biggest stars feel like they're jobbing actors.
Well, I think it's interesting, it's partly because in the UK, people, actors really do go backwards and forwards between film, television, theatre, and indeed radio, because radio acting is quite serious in the BBC. And I think that's part of what that's about, because, you know, if you do theatre, you, with very few exceptions, you do have to be part of an ensemble in some way, you know. Mm. But of course, you know, I mean, it would be disingenuous for anyone to suggest or suppose that all actors in the UK are intelligent, sophisticated, and creative, because quite a lot that are not, and I might say none of them are in any of my films. but you know, the very smart guys around, you know.
Have you run into them, or do you just vet them out long before
well,
they get to you?
I'm around on the scene. I mean, yeah, I run into them, of course.
But I mean, do you run into them on your? Have you ever hired one and gone, okay, I don't know, this one's gonna?
Well, I mean, not really, because that's unnecessary. And I work with a very brilliant and distinguished casting director, Nina Gold, who's cast lots of movies that you've seen, not just by me. Who points me in the direction of people and things. I mean, you make the occasional mistake, because that's what happens, but there are great people around, you know. It's a harvest, bumper crop all the time.
So this film, every time it gets shown in mass, in larger numbers, it gets this great wave of love. It happened in Cannes, it's happened recently in the UK with its release.
Well, today, it's released today.
Today's the day.
And it's had 5 stars right across the board in the UK, which is, in my experience, unprecedented. Mm. You know, it's extraordinary.
So do you get excited the way you did 25 years ago?
Oh, yeah. I mean, God, you know, there's no point in making movies if they don't get in front of audiences. And, you know, you get used to, well, it's doing okay, and, you know, he liked it, she didn't like it, they weren't sure, etc. When you get a film that seems, as Mr. Turner does, to sweep the board with enthusiasm, it's very good news indeed and very exciting, and, you know, makes you feel that he's not been wasting your time, really, you know.
So criticism matters to you? On some level.
Well, adulation, no. we're talking about two different things. It's not a question of criticism matters. I mean, criticism is interesting and important. And informed criticism is great. Of course, you get critics who are, you just know that they're not on the case, or they are consciously or subconsciously perpetrating some agenda or other, or some whinge or beef or something to do with something else, you know. But properly considered and intelligent and properly discussed criticism is very interesting and important, you know. But we're also talking about the audience is accessing and getting to see a movie. And in the end, audiences vote with their feet, you know, and you can tell by, you know, what the responses are. I mean, I you know, Hitchcock famously said more or less that a woman that spends all day washing and cleaning and ironing does not want to spend the evening watching a film about a woman who spends all day washing and cleaning and ironing. And I could not agree less with Hitchcock. I think it's rubbish, basically. Because in my experience, of course, people want to escape as well. Mm-hmm. But people, I've really experienced it over and over again, that people really get off on engaging with a world that they absolutely believe in and relate to, because it's about what they know and understand and the problems of life, you know. And that's what, you know, it's about. And then the interesting thing about Mr. Turner, which you can say, well, it's remote, it's 1825 to 1851, it's a long time ago, it's all that. It's not relevant to us, it's not now. But of course, it is a world that exists now when you experience it, and it's human, and it's about stuff that is, I would suggest, universal, without wanting to sound pretentious about it.
Well, emotion is universal. I mean, I think that's the thing, is that whether it's stick figures or the most beautiful images, yeah, or the most wonderful acting, yeah, if you connect with the emotion,
absolutely,
that's all there is.
Yeah, and this is a film in particular about life and death and, you know, relationships and parents and children and, you know, truth and denial and, you know, work. It's very much a film about work, doing something, and, you know, the down and dirty business of making something, you know.
And about saying what your work was. You know, I think for me that's a big part of this movie, is that moment where the public turns on him and braces it, you know, that the, yeah, question of your own value, having
absolutely
done the work, is
absolutely
profound.
No, and we've all been there. You know, you get negative reactions. And I mean, we made a film which also had Timothy Spall at the center of things, All or Nothing. Now, we all think, anyone that was involved with that for whatever reason, that film, it had a reasonably respectable initial airing, and it was in Cannes in competition, didn't win anything, but that's fine. But it kind of, we feel, without being in any way paranoid about it, we feel that it's a much better film than it was mostly appreciated as being. Mm-hmm. That it was more profound than people actually, it was dismissed in a curious way, and it's hard to know why, because the characters were so truthful, and you know all that. And you kind of at a certain level, you one has to say, well, I don't get it really. I don't know why that is, and yet another film takes off and really resonates with people, and he can't quite get what the difference is really. You know,
it is a weird phenomenon because you never know. I was thinking now, particularly doing this, and we're talking to people, and you know talk for half an hour. We talk to a lot of people. We do 200 of these plus a year, and it's like you never know when that moment's going to happen. That somehow is the moment that you've been waiting for the whole time.
I think that's right. Now, but the interesting thing about all of this, again, becomes something to think about clearly because we're in Hollywood as we speak. Is of course you have all these ridiculous people in this part of the world who try and, like medieval soothsayers and people practicing witchcraft or something, they think that they can get on top of that and anticipate things, and they think they understand the zeitgeist or whatever it is, and they think they can make formulae which solve the problem, so that we know what's going to be commercial, we know what's going to be successful, we know what they want, you know, which is of course complete and total bollocks really, because you can't. You can only work from a response to the world and what you think is interesting, and that's it, really. Who's to decide? Yeah, it's the centenary of Chaplin arriving in this town, and starting with Max Sennett and all the rest of it. I went to this Chaplin conference at Bologna at the Cinetech about 3 months ago, just to celebrate this centenary. And of course, it got us, you know, thinking about what the movies were like 100 years ago and how they made films, and you know, it's interesting to me because how Chaplin and Keaton and D.W. Griffiths and just about everybody else, and including Foyard in France particularly, how they made films was to get out there every day and say, okay, what should we do today? Let's make it up. Now that's what I do, except I mean, it's more complex because we prepare it, but still it's the joy of saying this is a medium that we can tell a story about whatever we want because we think it's interesting, because we think it's funny, because we think it's going to move people, or whatever it is. And there are no sort of committees of people with cigars, deciding it's this, that, or the other, and mostly getting it wrong. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's that freshness. It's what novelists do. Novelists do not don't form committees to decide what happens in the novel.
And painters, you know? Certainly.
Painters, poets. Musicians, you know, people just, you know, and of course the zeitgeist is on the go, and of course there are factions that you may or may not consciously or otherwise think or know that you're in some way part of, or trends or something, and of course, you know, you can look at movies in terms of the history of the movies, in terms of movies made before World War II, during World War II, and after World War II. And, you know, I grew up as a kid in Manchester watching only American and British movies, and the large proportion of the British movies that were war subjects. You know, I mean, that's what they made movies about, you know. So it's not a question of, you know, deciding what obscure thing your film's going to be. It comes out of what's going on, you know, whether you, in one way or another, you know. So I think, on the whole, we should all just get on with it, really, and do that in freedom and peace.